Hello, everybody. Welcome to another episode of Off the Cuff. This is the live stream. The show will start in 4 minutes. So I'm just getting everything ready to rock and roll before then. They finally turned the air conditioner on in here. I've been burning up, sweating. They got this fan too, but I can't have it on during the show because it just comes through the speakers and it just distorts the audio. Right, less than a minute and we will be live.
Radio Lex, the voice of the people. WLXU 93.9 LPFM, Lexington.
The views expressed on this program are not necessarily the views of Lexington Community Radio or its board of directors. The views expressed are solely those of the programmers.
You are listening to Off the Cuff. Here's your host, Adam Banks.
Welcome, everybody, to Off the Cuff. I am Adam Banks coming at you live from Lexington, Kentucky. Thank you for listening to the show, and thank you for tuning in to WLXU 93.9 FM. In addition to listening on the radio, you can check out our Facebook live stream at Off the Cuff with Adam Banks, or you could stream the show live from the station website at radiolex.us. It is August the 8th, 2024. Folks, I am broadcasting from the Deborah Hensley Studios here at Radio Lex on North Limestone. I tell you what, being just a college professor working in this field. I am feeling right along with the students of what it's like to go back to school. I've been seeing some school buses in Fayette County. I am a little confused by that because I don't think school has officially started back in Fayette County. But folks, we are now here at the time of school starting back. Summer vacation is over for all of you kiddos. And I tell you what, I am feeling it for you guys right now. But the last time we were here on Off the Cuff with Adam Banks, last week we did a Josie Music preview show where I went over some of the nominees in the business music business category. And since I was included in that category for Radio Show of the Year, I thought it would be interesting to bring on some other people nominated in the same field. And you can check that out in our archives. But we haven't done regular programming in 2 weeks, so a lot has happened. And the biggest thing that has happened over the last 2 weeks is Kamala Harris picking her vice presidential running mate. The Minnesota governor, Tim Walz, was virtually unknown up until Kamala Harris named him as the VP candidate. Now, she is saying that he will be the new VP. Only time will tell. I never knew who he was. If you're asking if he made a big impact, I don't really see a big impact. I honestly think it was a dud as far as going for a big impact on the campaign. I'm not saying that him as a person is a dud. I don't know much about him just yet. But as far as making a splash, I don't know what Tim Walz did for her campaign. You've got Shapiro, who was potentially supposed to be her running mate. He was the governor of Pennsylvania, and she decided last minute that she was not going to pick him. I think he would have made a splash. It seems like the state really loves him. It's a swing state, and it would have solidified that state for her, I think, if she would have picked Shapiro as her vice president. But she picked the Minnesota governor, Tim Walz. And if you're like me, you don't know much about him either. So I have done some digging, and I would like to give you some Governor Tim Walz facts. One thing that I find completely bizarre and insane about him is that he does not drink coffee. Now, I am a coffee drinker. I drink it every day, multiple times a day. I've had people tell me that I am the only person that they have ever seen that they can watch me fall asleep on a couch with a cup of coffee in my hand. I can drink it in the mornings and it'll wake me up, and I can drink it at night and it will put me down. I don't know what it is, but I just love coffee. And when people say they don't drink it, I find that very, very bizarre. But he does not drink coffee. He says he would prefer a diet Mountain Dew as his drink of choice to give him a little pep in his step. He is the one who started the whole weird thing. You know how J.D. Vance is being called weird and Donald Trump is being called weird? If you ever wondered where that come from, where did this whole weird concept come from? That was Minnesota Governor Tim Walz who started the whole thing. Something interesting about Tim Walz, while he was governor of Minnesota, he named a highway after Prince and signed the bill in purple ink. If you don't know why he did that, Prince, the famous pop star who tragically passed in 2016, was from the state of Minnesota. Tim Walz, if he reminds you of a high school teacher or a high school coach, that's because he is a previous high school teacher and a coach. And he gives off teacher vibes. He does give off coach vibes. He really does. I mean, he's kind of like, I've heard people say that he's giving off dad vibes. He's got very much of a dad demeanor, which is fine with me, but he did teach high school social studies and geography before he entered politics, and he was a basketball coach, but nonetheless, he was a coach in high school. He taught in China in 1989 and speaks some Mandarin. He is also a veteran. He enlisted in the Army National Guard as a teenager and retired at 24 years later in 2005. It seems like a lot of people in the military like to transition over into politics. He was born in Nebraska. He picked the person to be his lieutenant governor. The female he picked to be his lieutenant governor was a woman who trained him at a political camp. There was a political camp that he attended that taught you pretty much how to be a politician. And his teacher, he liked so well. He chose her to be his running mate, and they eventually won the governor's seat. He was an early supporter of gay rights. He is a big, has a lot of progression in his politics. He is usually one to speak out against a lot of things like gun control or gay marriage. He is very, very on the left on a lot of issues. He has shifted politically on a lot of issues. For instance, he was more moderate than many Democrats during his time in the House. So, for instance, he has been known to give endorsements for the National Rifle Association. However, he'll turn around and then speak poorly about the NRA. And he'll say that they're a good association, and then one minute he'll say they're a bad association. So he does flip-flop a lot when it comes to gun control. He is a big hunter. He hunts peasants and turkeys. So we know that he is somebody who is in favor of firearms. He would be the third vice president, if elected, from Minnesota. Hubert Humphrey, who served under President Lyndon B. Johnson, and Walter Mondale, who served under President Jimmy Carter, were the first two. He and his wife had their two children through veto fertilization. That is the IVF treatment. I'm not really entirely sure what that is. I believe that has something to do with, I don't know if it has something to do with a man's sperm going into another woman's frozen eggs. I'm not really sure. I've never looked into IVF. But I know it's very popular for people who struggle with having kids the natural way. It says here that he was a football coach. Okay, so that clarifies what type of coach he was. And he actually won a state championship in 1999, the football state championship. That is nothing to scoff at, folks. A state championship for a coach? Some coaches coach their entire life and can't get it. He did it in 1999 at Mankato West High School. He is a Lutheran. He doesn't drink alcohol. After a DWI in 1995, he says that it was that made him stop drinking and put the bottle down for good. But those are just a few little facts about your potential vice president, Tim Walz. And the Democratic convention is coming up in just a couple of weeks. This election keeps heating up, and there's always more to talk about as things develop. But folks, we have a great show ahead of you today here on Off the Cuff with Adam Banks. Stick with us. We will be right back.
WNSU 93.9 LPFM, Lexington, Kentucky.
Radio Lex only exists in our community because of the generosity of supporting members like Richard Seckel. Thank you for your ongoing commitment to the voice of the people. To learn how you can become a supporting member, visit radiolex.us/donate.
Jira ya baridi ni vizuri wewe ndugu na familia yako kujilinda kwa kupata chanjo ya corona na mafua. Kwa mengi tembelea tovuti refshd.org. Tujitahidi wote tupate chanjo.
$1,000 for anybody who can tell me what language that was.
Let's go places safely, Lexington. Kentucky roads can be a dangerous place. Over 24,000 collisions and 700 fatalities occurred last year. The number one factor in all of these collisions? Not paying attention. I'm Amy from Toyota, reminding you to keep your eyes and your mind on the road.
Welcome back, everybody, to Off the Cuff. Adam Banks here with you. Norah O'Donnell, the head anchor of CBS Evening News, will be leaving the anchor chair. She took over the seat in 2019. Now, the Evening News used to be a staple in this country, and it still is. And I say it used to be just It still is. The reason I say it used to be is because the internet and streaming has made other news so accessible. But at one point in time in America, there was nothing like the evening news. There was three big stations, ABC, CBS, and NBC. And every network had a newscast, 5 o'clock, and they had one anchor behind the desk that told the world the news. And you had to pick back in the day because the news was on the was on at the same time. All the networks showed the evening news all at the same time, and they still do today. So you still, if you watch the evening news, you have to pick and choose who you want to watch. Most of the time when somebody picks a newscast to watch, they stick with that newscast. They're very loyal to that news anchor. They're very loyal to that station, that network. So a lot of people were impacted by the decision of Norah O'Donnell deciding to leave CBS News. Now, let's be honest, she was asked to leave CBS News. The ratings had been in the tank for many, many, many months or many years at this point at CBS Evening News. The number one newscast right now is ABC with David Muir. And then you've got NBC at number two with Lester Holt. Now, Norah O'Donnell comes in at number three with CBS Evening News. CBS Evening News used to always be number one when it comes to the newscast. You got to think about the icons that have sat behind the anchor desk at CBS. You had Dan Rather. You had Walter Cronkite, and now you got Norah O'Donnell, a very underwhelming person to read the news. Norah O'Donnell. Now, it has nothing to do with her gender. There have been many, many great female news anchors that have done well. For instance, at one point in time, ABC hired Barbara Walters to do the news. I think that it was CBS that had Katie Couric at one time. So there have been people who have, there have been women who have done the evening news and it's been successful, but you can't say the same for Norah O'Donnell. It was very underwhelming and she has done pitiful as the lead anchor for CBS Evening News. When she took over the anchor seat, they moved the newscast from New York City to Washington. I don't know why they did that. New York is the center of the world, and I feel like that newscast in America should be broadcasted from New York City. Why you put it in the nation's capital? I can see the logic, but it didn't have no aura. It didn't have no appeal about it. But she does deserve to lose her job because of her rivals absolutely destroying her in the ratings. It says here that CBS plans to have rotating anchors after Norah O'Donnell departs in November. CBS anchors John Dickerson and Marcy Du Bois will be the rotating anchors until they decide upon a new anchor. Norah O'Donnell has had a tumultuous ride as the latest journalist, but she could not live up to her expectations of Walter Cronkite and Dan Rather. Of course not. It says here that she has scored big interviews over the years, but every interview that she has scored has very poor ratings, regardless of who it is that she's interviewing. You're talking about a news network, folks, a newscast, CBS, who used to be number one. That used to be everybody's news because of the famous anchors behind the desk. And a newscast is only as good as the news anchor. There have been a lot of great news anchors out there, but let's be honest, people don't watch the newscast for the network. They watch it for the anchor. And CBS, they've let her have the seat too long, 5 years, and they're like, okay, enough. We're tanking in the ratings. So Norah O'Donnell will be leaving CBS in November. So she's waiting until after the election, but she will be leaving. And CBS made a lot of changes when they put Norah O'Donnell in the seat. Not only did they change the location, but they changed the evening news theme music. CBS had the same theme music for multiple decades. Some of the best anchors that ever sat at the anchor's desk had the CBS theme music that they changed. Walter Cronkite used the same music. Dan Rather used the same CBS evening music. When Norah O'Donnell took over, they completely changed the music. Why? Why change something that works? Everybody associated the theme music of CBS Evening News with that newscast. And when they changed it, it was just another colossal fail. And it made me start thinking of some other newscast and some other newscast evening news theme songs that other newscasts have had. And there's been a lot of great ones. And it's very important to create a very catchy and a very impactful theme music for your newscast. News is very particular. You have to be very particular when you're choosing what type of music you want to put on your newscast. You can't have anything that sounds too silly. You can't have anything that sounds too serious. It's got to be a healthy balance. I definitely think CBS, though, has one of the best theme music to have ever existed for a newscast. Here is the original CBS evening news theme that Norah O'Donnell changed. And that was the original CBS evening news anchor. And then you had Dan Rather pop up on the screen. You had Walter Cronkite pop up on the screen. And when Norah O'Donnell came in, they just completely changed it. And they were like, yeah, this theme music worked for the last 50 years. Let's change it. Yeah, that was smart. This was the first what do you call music without words? Instrumental. This was the first instrumental CBS evening news theme, and they stuck with this theme for decades. And I cannot believe they changed it. And it was just another reason of why CBS was no longer in the ranking for best newscast between the big three networks. So what are some of the best evening news theme music throughout time? Well, we started off with CBS, but folks, there is a lot more. What about the ABC evening newscast? ABC has one of the best, most recognizable newscast of all time, and it's this one right here. This music is very distinct, and it's easy identifiable. It's got four notes that they've never changed, and it's the bow, 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 bow. Those four notes right there have always been included into the ABC evening news theme music. Now, throughout the years, they've kind of changed the theme. Not much. They stay true to the original. But those four notes, the brown, 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 has always been synonymous with ABC News. This theme music was written by a man named Bob Israel. David Muir is currently the news anchor for ABC News. In my opinion, David Muir, you can't beat him. I think he's the best. He's the best one right now out there. ABC News is the number one ranked news broadcast between the big three networks. So, if you're wondering what CBS calls their newscast, they call it the CBS Evening News. ABC calls their newscast World News Tonight. ABC also uses this theme music for their news on radio. So it's not only synonymous with the ABC World News Tonight broadcast, but it's also anytime ABC News is doing any type of news on the radio, they use this theme music. Now, yes, CBS has a great theme song. They've got great theme music. ABC, they've got great theme music. But folks, I feel like the best evening news theme music of all time is from NBC Nightly News. And what's so special about this news theme music is that it was created by composer John Williams. Take a listen. Now, I don't know if you guys know who John Williams is. John Williams is quite possibly the most famous composer of all time. He is the mastermind behind the music of Star Wars, Jurassic Park, Jaws, Home Alone, and he's also the mastermind behind the NBC Nightly News theme music. And no wonder it's such a brilliant theme music. You've got the greatest of all time creating the music for you. At the time John Williams was approached to write the NBC News Suite, he was already well known for his other work, like Superman, E.T., so many movies, I can just keep naming them off. They already knew him, the world already knew him for his work. But a lot of people probably didn't know that he was the one that created the NBC Nightly News theme. NBC engaged John Williams due to the network's desire to contrast with the synthesized music common for news programs at the time. John Williams stated he wanted to convey the concepts of nobility, of purpose, consistency, and dignity. So he said this was a very challenging process. It took him hours and days and days and hours to create and come up with the perfect news suite. He said it was very challenging because he said he wanted to portray and convey nobility, purpose, consistency, and dignity. That's hard to do in music. In movies, it's easy to just create something exciting, create something dramatic. When you're creating music for a newscast, it takes a lot more than what you would create for a movie. You've got the whole world you're thinking about. You've got to appeal to everybody, not just a certain audience. You have to appeal to everybody. NBC Nightly News has used this theme music since September 9th, 1985, and I don't think they'll ever go away from it. The reason other networks decided to use their own theme music for their evening news was because of the NBC Nightly News theme music. This was so popular, this was so beloved by all of America, they were like, CBS and ABC was like, we have to get in on this. We have to somehow chip in on this music business for our news theme cast. The music that a news network uses is very important. What I love about the NBC Nightly News theme, folks, is the beginning of this news cast. Like, listen at the beginning of this theme music. It just screams, pay attention to me. It just screams importance. When you hear it, automatically your attention, right from the beginning, the very first note, you are just glued to your TV because you know what's about to be shown is very dramatic and very important. And no other network was able to accomplish this. Not CBS, not ABC, but NBC was, thanks to John Williams. Take a listen at just the beginning of this nightly news theme, and you'll be familiar with it when you hear it because you hear it every day at 6 o'clock. Take a listen. I mean, how amazing is the first few chords of the music? Take a listen again. I mean, that is dramatic. That is importance. That makes me a little scared. That makes me a little anxious when I hear that. I'm like, oh no. Whatever they're talking about right now is very important when you hear that music. Take a listen. They start out playing those notes right at the beginning, and then they start off with their top story, their top headline. So John Williams done such a beautiful, brilliant job with this theme music. But folks, that is not all of great theme music for evening newscast. What about Fox News. Fox News is their own 24-hour news station. Fox News has been around for a long, long time, but they also have their own specific evening newscast. Take a listen. Now, Fox doesn't particularly go on at a certain time of day. They do news all throughout the day. But the channel itself, when it's talking about news, does have this as their official news theme music. Fox was launched 27 years ago, October 7th, 1996, and they've used this music the whole time. You might recognize this music on radio as well if you listen to Fox News Radio. A lot of radio stations will have some type of news. And usually the news from radio stations come from a big network, ABC, CBS, NBC, and sometimes Fox News. They buy news from Fox. And when you do hear news from Fox, you always hear this. Fox is the conservative version of the news. CNN's very liberal. Fox is very conservative. So usually you got to pick a side of what you want to watch. The networks, though, they try to balance the best they can. They try to hire liberals at Fox News. They try to hire conservatives at CNN. And they both do, to a sense. But we all know the stigma Fox News has. They're very much a conservative station. And they're very biased towards conservative viewpoints. And then finally, folks, on my list is one of the best evening news theme songs of all time. Comes from the other 24-hour news station, CNN. And this is from their broadcast, World News. And again, folks, they don't have a particular time of when the news comes on. It's completely 24/7. But when they do show any type of news broadcast, they always associate it with this music. Now, I like CNN. I like their news coverage. I think they do a very good job with covering news. Now, a lot of their viewpoints I don't like. They're, like I said, they're very biased, just like Fox News is. They have a very liberal, they have a very left-winged viewpoint. But as far as production, as far as coverage, they do a great job. On election night, I always watch CNN. Usually when there's a breaking story in America, I turn on CNN. So a lot of you all are probably already used to hearing this music. If you tune in to CNN for any of your news. CNN was founded by Ted Turner, who also owned the wrestling company WCW. Ted Turner came up with the idea of CNN while smoking a joint in his office in the 80s. I love that story. A lot of people talk about how people who smoke pot are stupid. People who smoke pot is this and that. I mean, one of the most brilliant concepts of all time was thought of and created and implemented while Ted Turner was high off of marijuana. Speaking of that, while we're talking about that, it became legal in Ohio this past weekend. Dispensaries, recreational, have opened up all across Cincinnati and other areas in Ohio. So no wonder there's been a lot of smoke in the air coming from Cincinnati. I guess it's all coming from Ohio. Big turnouts there. But I digress. That, folks, is some of the best news, evening news theme songs throughout time. CBS, ABC, NBC, Fox News, and CNN. A lot of networks, they try to have their own news broadcast. Sometimes it works, sometimes it don't. But what's very important, regardless of what channel you're on, is the music that you attach to your broadcast. Because people associate it with that, people get used to things, and people love familiarity, people love being used to things. So creating a good music suite for your newscast is so, so crucial. But that, folks, I feel like is some of the best evening newscast theme songs throughout time. But folks, we still have lots more Off the Cuff with Adam Banks coming at you live after these words. Stick with us. We will be right back.
We are Radio Lex, WLXU 93.9 LPFM, Lexington, Kentucky.
WLXU 93.9 LPFM broadcasts live 24/7 from the Deborah Hensley Studio inside the Gray Line Station. Deborah Hensley, State Farm Agent. DeborahHensley.com.
Everybody's favorite cousin, Shook Nasty. Make sure you tune in to Cash or Trash Radio on Radio Lex, WLXU 93.9 with your girl, Cash Love.
Did you know one out of every four traffic fatalities in the United States is a result of speeding? Hi, this is Scott with State Farm, reminding you to be a good neighbor. Take it easy, slow down, and get where you're going safely.
Radio Lex only exists in our community because of the generosity of supporting members like Arthur Sechet. Thank you for your ongoing commitment to the voice of the people. To learn how you can become a supporting member, visit radiolex.us/donate.
Said you don't got time to waste, but I hope maybe that you might like a change, yeah. Private club gon' fly, oh, you gotta take some advice. Thank you, you be myself, see that, so I'll see myself, stop holding on.
Welcome back, everybody, to Off the Cuff. Adam Banks here with you. August the 8th, slap dab still right in the middle of summer. Some argue that August is even hotter than July. But July, 31 days we had in July. We've got 31 days in August. 31 days for a month is a long time. July, a lot happened in those 31 days. This is our first regular broadcast of August. I'm not counting last week because that was a Josie music preview show, but this is really our first broadcast, regular broadcast of August. So what I would like to do is just kind of go through a recap of some of the biggest stories that happened in July of this year. And when I talk about some of these things, you're going to be surprised of how much actually happened just in the last 31 days for the month of July. For instance, on July 1st, the U.S. Supreme Court ruled that ex-presidents have immunity from prosecution for all official acts altering the 2020 election interference case against Donald Trump. I disagree with that. I don't think that anybody should be immune from prosecution, even presidents or former presidents of the United States. You're still a citizen. You work for the country. It doesn't make you a better person. It doesn't make you any different than a regular citizen. Now, of course, you have a lot of power, and of course, you have a lot of prestige as the president. However, you should not be immune to prosecution. You should not be immune to not getting arrested. But apparently that is now the case for ex-presidents. They have immunity from prosecution for all official acts. Unbelievable. But that is a new rule here in this country. July 5th, U.S. President Joe Biden gives an interview to quell fears about his stamina and cognitive abilities with ABC's George Stephanopoulos. Listen, I wanted to talk about that interview, that press conference when he had it. But he had that, and that was supposed to be his press conference where he was going to come out and convince America that he was cognitively able to be the president. But he went out and completely failed at that too. He was stumbling over his words. That's when he called. That's when he said he was glad that he picked Donald Trump as his vice president instead of saying Kamala Harris. He's just all over the place. Even listening to Joe Biden talk now, because he don't talk much. They've kept him hid away in the last week or two. But even when you still hear him talk, he still fumbles over words. He cannot make it through a 2 or 3 minute public appearance without fumbling. I'll be surprised if he makes it to January as our president. I see a resignation from Joe Biden very, very soon before his presidency is up. And if that happens, that will be the first time since Richard Nixon that this has happened. And Richard Nixon, some say, is the worst president of all time. I personally say that it's Joe Biden, Richard Nixon number two. But there you go. We could think about what all we have seen this election so far. We've seen an assassination attempt. We've seen a president decide not to run or re-seek election, first since Lyndon B. And now we possibly could see a resignation from a current president. I seriously think it will happen before January. July 13th, former U.S. President Donald Trump survives an assassination attempt, and we've covered that in great detail in our archives. July 17th, the Mirage Hotel and Casino on the Las Vegas Strip closes after 34 years. I never stayed at the Mirage. I've seen it many times when I've been out at Vegas. I've seen it on the Strip. You see it in the skyline of the Vegas Strip on television, in pictures, on posters. And it's been a staple on the Strip in Vegas for years, 34 years to be exact. When a hotel in Vegas closes down, it is very impactful for the city because, like I was talking about with familiarity, people love things they're used to. People love being able to be used to things. And people were used to seeing the Mirage on the Vegas Strip for over 30 years. And now it's not there anymore. They have rebranded the hotel. They've called it something completely different. So when you go back to Vegas now, you will not see the Mirage Hotel and Casino on the Las Vegas Strip. That's not the first hotel on the Strip to close down. There has been many hotels that close down and they get reopened and rebranded as new hotels. It's nothing that's changed. But the reason this is a big story is because of its longevity. 34 years. It stayed in business 34 years since 1994. So everybody that was in Vegas in the mid-90s and all of the new millennium so far has seen the Mirage Hotel on the Strip, but you will not see it anymore. July 24th was the Inside Out 2 movie that was released, and it surpassed Frozen 2 to become the highest grossing animated film in history, making $1.46 billion worldwide. I've never even heard of Inside Out 2. I've heard of Frozen, but never Inside Out 2. So it's crazy to me to think that Inside Out 2 surpassed Frozen 2 as the highest grossing animated film in history, $1.46 billion worldwide. To me, that just tells me that they don't make great animated films anymore. I think the best animated films are the ones like Toy Story, Aladdin, Cinderella, Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs, The Lion King. And now they're coming out with animated movies like Frozen, stop it, Inside Out 2, come on. July 21st, U.S. President Joe Biden abandons his campaign for re-election and endorses Vice President Kamala Harris. We have discussed that in complete detail in our archives. July 22nd, Eminem's The Death of Slim Shady album was his 11th album to reach number one, replacing Taylor Swift's The Tortured Poets Department after 12 weeks at the top. Eminem's new album is him talking about the death of his alter ego, Slim Shady. If you remember when Eminem first started out in the 90s, he was under the name, well, of course he went by Eminem, but he was really under the stage name Slim Shady. And he was very, very different in his music sound. His sound was very different. His style was different. He had the bleach blonde hair and he was very raunchy. And he threw up his middle finger at a lot of just issues and things. And he was just very, very off the beaten path. Now Eminem has grown up. He's progressed. He has changed. He has evolved. And his new album is basically just talking about the new him and how Slim Shady is dead. But his album is the number one album in the world right now. It has finally taken down a Taylor Swift album. July 23rd, China announces plans to raise its retirement age from 60 for men and 55 for women. Currently, right now, The age to retire for women is 50, and the age to retire for men is 55. Well, China is going to raise that for both genders. They're going to have it to where men can retire at 60 and women at 55. So it's absolutely crazy to me that here in America, we are the greatest country in the world, but we still make our citizens work longer. There's a lot of things we do claim to be the greatest country in the world, and I agree with that sentiment. You know how patriotic I am, folks. You know I love this country, but there's a lot of things that we do that we're not number one in. Healthcare, retirement, that stuff needs to be revised. That stuff needs to be looked into. There is no, here in America, to get the max amount of your Social Security, you have to work until you're 70 years old. 70 years. What can you do in good health at 70 years old? Now, there's a lot of people out there in good health at 70, and then there's a lot that's not. So I just think it's a shame that you have to work until you're 70 to draw your max amount of retirement. China seems to have that in order in the right place. So 60 for men, 55 for women. July 23rd, the U.S. Secret Service Director Kimberly Cheadle, she stepped down after the agency failed to prevent an assassination attempt on Donald Trump. Do yourself a favor and go to YouTube and look at some of those amazing, look at some of those amazing clips from that trial of Director Kimberly Cheadle on the stand when the lawyers are cross-examining her about what went down during that assassination attempt on Trump. What a colossal failure that was. She had one job, to protect the president, and he was almost killed by a kid on top of a roof. What's the first thing you secure as a Secret Service agent? You secure rooftops. She did not. Not only did she not secure rooftops, she did not secure one of the closest rooftops with the best view of taking the president's head off. So, of course, she stepped down. Should have been fired immediately, but she did step down. And that, folks, pretty much wraps up the big events and the big headlines of the month of July. And think about what all has just happened. Wrap your mind around what all has happened in this country in just 31 days. There's been a lot. And while you wrap your mind around it, folks, how about a little song of the week? With a little Teddy Swims, The Door. Sit back, relax, roll down them windows if you're in your car, and we'll be back after the song. The 2024 Summer Olympics are officially underway. They have officially been branded as the Paris 2024 Olympics. It's an international multi-sport event that takes place every 4 years. This year, it's taken place from July 24th to August the 11th. So we're almost finished with the Summer Olympics. I'm all for it. I love the Olympics. I love watching the different games. You don't get to see those games, but every 4 years. And it's amazing to watch these different sports and how good people are at them. You're watching the best people in the world compete at a level of greatness. Everybody that's in these competitions, everybody is the best in their field. So you've got the best swimmers around the world competing against each other. Basketball players around the world competing against each other. So a lot of great Summer Olympics has been happening this summer. Right now, as we stand, and this was at 11 o'clock this morning. This is the official Olympic medal table count that we have so far. Now, this has obviously changed, I am sure, since 11 o'clock this morning because the Summer Olympics happen all throughout the day. But right now, here is where we're standing. United States with 27 gold medals, gold being the highest, 35 silver, and 33 bronze, with a total of 95 medals. Right now, the United States leads the rest of the world with gold medals in the Olympics. China's number two, 26 gold, 24 silver, 17 bronze. Australia at number three, 18 gold, 14 silver, 11 bronze. France comes in at number four with 13 gold, 17 silver, 21 bronze. And Great Britain comes in at number five with 12 gold, 17 silver, and 20 bronze. Still lots of Olympics to be talked about. And we'll talk more in detail about the Olympics next week because they'll be closed and it will be complete. And we can go over the final tally of how many medals each country won. But let's go USA. Right now we're leading at number one. Let's keep that momentum up. You guys keep going out there and doing your thing. But folks, we still have one more segment to go right here on Off the Cuff. Stick with us. We'll be right back.
اسمعوا يا رجال، نحن منشغلون بالعمل من أجل عائلاتنا ودعم أهلنا. ليس من السهل دائما التفكير على صحتنا. لذلك ستتحدى نفسك هذا الشهر. اذهب إلى الطبيب. أجري فحصا على قلبك ورئتيك وضغط دمك. احرص على تلقي جميع لقاحاتك المقررة. اهتم، تصرف. يأتيكم هذا الإعلان برعاية راديو لاكس إذاعتنا المحلية. لمعرفة المزيد زوروا موقع radiolex.us.
WLXU 93.9 LPFM broadcasts live 24/7 from the Deborah Hensley Studio inside the Gray Line Station. Deborah Hensley, State Farm Agent. DeborahHensley.com.
Everybody to Off the Cuff. Adam Banks here with you. Last segment of the hour. Today's national holiday is National Dollar Day, which is observed every August on the 8th here in the United States. This observance marks an important event in the history of the country, and that is when the monetary system was established. In fact, in early 2021, the U.S. currency in circulation is estimated to be around $2.10 trillion. That means, folks, there is $2.10 trillion of American money circulating around the world. It is the dollar. The dollar, the U.S. dollar, is used as an exchange and accepted in multiple countries, not just the United States. You can use U.S. currency in other countries. That's why when people see Americans in other countries, they go wild, thinking we're just the richest people in the world because we can use our money in these countries and a lot of things are not as expensive in other places compared to America. So you take your currency that you have in this country over to a third world country, for instance, you're going to be a loaded, wealthy man or woman in their eyes. Paper money dollars are currently known as Federal Reserve notes, and their designs were based on the Spanish dollar. In fact, the single dollar bill has not been redesigned in more than 50 years to prevent counterfeiting. The first paper dollar that was printed in 1862 had Abraham Lincoln's Secretary of Treasury, listen to this, Solomon P. Chase, printed on it. You guys might recognize that name from the law school in Northern Kentucky. He was the guy who was on the original dollar bill. How about that? They changed it to George Washington. That seems to be the most appropriate figure to have on U.S. currency as the first president versus a former Secretary of State. The United States dollar is used, like I said, in other countries around the world. So your money is good in other places, not just here. It takes approximately under a nickel per note to produce the $1 bill, making it one of the cheapest bills to create in the world. The dollar is 2.61 inches in width and 6.14 inches long. The dollar weighs approximately 1 gram and is 0.0043 inches thick. The dollar is made from a blend of paper, which is approximately 75% cotton and 25% linen. That's why dollars are, they don't just kind of wither away when you get them wet. You can wash up your wallet with $200 in there, and you can lay your money out and dry it, and it'll be fine. Just like laying out a wet shirt after you get it out of the washer. You can lay out your money and dry it out. The reason is because of the material. It's cotton and linen, folks. A dollar may spend around 6 years in circulation on average. I love receiving a dollar where you have the little stamp on it that says wheresgeorge.com, and you can go to that website and you can figure out where that particular dollar, whose hands it's been in throughout its life. Now, not everybody fills in that information, but you'll get a good idea of where that dollar has been just by looking at that website. You can celebrate National Dollar Day by doing the following. You could spend a dollar. You could analyze a dollar. When I say analyze, just look it over. The dollar has got a fascinating design about it. And then the last way to celebrate it is to save a dollar. You don't always have to spend your money. You can always save it and put it back for a rainy day. But that, folks, is today's national holiday. Happy National Dollar Day. But folks, that pretty much wraps up another episode of Off the Cuff with Adam Banks. If you liked what you heard today, you'll probably like our previous episodes. We upload all of our previous episodes on podcasts. We're on Apple, Spotify, YouTube, or wherever you stream your favorite podcast. You can follow the show on social media at Off the Cuff with Adam Banks. You can follow me, the host, on social media at The Adam Banks. We release new episodes every Thursday from 4 to 5 right here on WLXU 93.9 FM, which means we will be back next week, same time, same place. Ladies and gentlemen, this is Off the Cuff, and I am the King of Radio, Adam Banks. I'll catch you down the road. All right, guys, thank you so much. See you later.